Hello, and God bless you all, my friends. Welcome to The Mystery of the Shroud, Who is the Man in the Cloth? I'm your host, Phillip Campbell, author, historian, educator, and I'm here to talk about the Shroud of Turin, back again with our guest, Tony Cherniawski. How are you doing, Tony?
Very good, Phil. Thank you.
So in our last episode, we were talking about the image itself and the wounds on the image on the Shroud of Turin and how much they correspond to what we know of the wounds of Christ. And we had just gotten through talking about the front of the image. Let's talk about the back of the image. There's scourging marks all over the man on the shroud. Tell us about
That's
the scourging
right.
wounds.
These scourge wounds are most noticeable on the back, but they go from top to bottom. In other words, from his shoulders, the top of his shoulders, all the way down to the heels of his feet. So there's not an inch of his body that was spared from the scourging. And not only is it in the back of the body, it's on the front of the body as well. And investigators, forensic investigators, have looked at that, and they've counted as many as 373 marks, individual wounds, which would be done by what's called a Roman whip,
flagellum.
A flagellum, that's right, that would have three leather thongs attached to the end of a handle, and at the end of the leather thongs would be either knuckle bones from the sheep or possibly lead that's sharpened to points on each side. So they'd be lead barbells, basically, at the end of the leather thongs.
And so this isn't a nice, dandy little switch like we see in the paintings sometimes?
Not at all. And yet, one of the things that I want to say is the one area that Mel Gibson took a little bit of artistic license was the fact that they were using a whip in the movie with hooks in it, and that wasn't correct. So it wasn't quite as brutal as he had pointed out, but still, nonetheless, these wounds actually pierced the skin. And so what we saw, or what we do see on the back and the body where we can see the wounds, the scourging, is actual blood flow coming out of each one of these points. And so what you would usually see is that these scourge marks would be in threes, representing the whips that were used. And not only that, but from the pattern of the scourging, we know that there were two soldiers, one on each side. The one soldier was taller and didn't whip quite as strongly. The other one was shorter, and he was brutal. His scourge marks were much deeper and much more pronounced.
He had something to prove because he was littler.
Possibly, yes. That happens. That happens sometimes. So the thing is that when you count 373, I believe it comes out to 126 lashes with the flagellum.
That's
excessive.
That is, and having studied Roman history myself for many, I mean, that is enough to kill a man.
That's right.
People could be sentenced to be scourged to death, and that amount of scourging be a death sentence. It's no wonder that Jesus died on the cross before they expected him to.
That's right. Now, let's put that into a little bit of historical context as well, because the Jews had a rule, a law about scourging. You could not scourge a man more than 40 times mm-hmm. With 40 lashes. So they have a saying, it's 40 minus 1. Okay, so they always made sure that that anybody that was scourged only got 39 lashes. And the main reason why is that this was meant to be a punishment, not to end in death. Okay, but it was to be a severe enough punishment that this man knew who was being scourged. He knew he was being punished, okay? Mm-hmm. At the same time, the Romans had no such compunction about that whatsoever. They simply went at it. to the point where many of their victims would have died under the scourge itself. So we have that part of it that goes the entire part of his back. The scourging was, it appears that the scourging went wrapped around his sides. He also was probably turned over because we see scourge marks on his front as well.
Mm. So tell us about the blood flow from the scourging.
Well, the blood flow from the scourging, most of that blood was would have been venous, what we call venous blood, which means that it would just coagulate in where the wounds were. You would not see a lot of blood flow out of the scourge marks.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a blood flow across the back that came from the wound in the side.
Mm.
And so the blood and water was still coming out of his side when they carried him from the, you know, took him down from the cross and carried him to the tomb. And it's apparent that because of the angle or how he is carried or what have you, that there is a horizontal flow of blood across the small of his back. And you can see not just the blood. By the way, that blood can be described as post-mortem blood because you have thin trickles of blood that has a halo of serum around it. So in other words, the serum is separating from the blood, and so that's where. And possibly some of that serum might have been from the pericardium.
Mm.
So we have what's called pericardial fluid, which
the chamber by the heart, right?
That's right. It actually cushions the heart. So right. That's one of the reasons why you don't feel your heart beating unless you're lying down very still, because the pericardium actually it cushions the heartbeat itself. So it's not. It's only apparent to using a medical device or if you're very very quiet. So that water-filled chamber around the heart may have been where the water came from that flowed out of his side when the spear entered his side.
Fascinating. Now, what about the crucifixion wounds on the feet?
Well, there's two parts to that that I want to say. First of all, it's hard to show or hard to determine exactly where the nails went. There are many different opinions because there's a huge flow of blood on the cloth. His right foot, I believe, shows the sole of the foot actually lying on the cloth itself. So if you think about that, he's lying horizontally in the cloth, and yet you see the entire bottom of the entire sole in contact with the cloth, and it's all smeared with blood. It appears that there may have been two exit wounds from the nails in the feet. One would have been in front of the heel. I'm not a medical expert, so I can't tell you the exact name of it. But the other nail, interestingly enough, might have gone directly through his heel bone or somewhere very, very close to it. So there is a huge amount of blood, relatively speaking, right where the heel touches the cloth.
So crucifixes tend to portray his feet one on top of the other with a single nail through the both of them. But if I'm understanding you right, you're saying the shroud seems to suggest there was two nails and that his feet may have been turned outward with the nails going through the heel?
Actually, believe it or not, it would be difficult to describe, but first of all, what is being shown on the cloth itself is that the feet, when they were nailed to the cross, were not nailed to any kind of horizontal footrest. Okay, there was no footrest there. There was no pedestal.
They were nailed right to the vertical beam.
Right to the vertical beam. That's correct. And that's how we get the one foot where we get the entire imprint of the foot on the horizontal cloth.
Hmm.
Okay, and so the other foot is harder to determine, first of all, because there's less blood coming from it, and apparently there's no exit wounds that are in direct contact with the cloth itself. So we do see smears of blood there, but and sort of a vague imprint of a foot that's been turned. So it's possible, it's really hard to say. There's arguments
yeah.
both ways. One of the arguments is that they could have used one nail and put the left foot over the right on the cross itself. That would be a little bit hard to do. More likely, there was a good chance that two nails were being used.
So now that we've looked at all the wounds of the man on the shroud, let's talk about some of the particulars of the image, the characteristics of the image itself. Like, for example, just what color is this image?
Well, the color of the image is what we'd probably call a sepia tones, a light brown color. And the cloth itself is yellowish because the linen faded over time and darkened because of age. So the thing that we see here is this is what makes the image very hard to see. A lot of times people will come up, and that's why I was saying earlier in an earlier program that there's other parts to the shroud that sort of take your view away from the man and the cloth.
Right.
Okay, so
other things that draw the eye.
Right, because those are darker, they're more pronounced, and the image of the man and the cloth is very, very light.
How deep is the image of the man and the cloth?
The image on the cloth is about 1/1000th of an inch in depth. So if you think about how this image got there, first of all, one of the first things the Shroud of Turin research people team did is they took apart the backing from the shroud. It was held together by a backing. They went within the backing itself. They went between the backing and the shroud to look to see if the image appeared on the other side. And the answer is no, it did not appear at all. There was blood, there was water stains, there were burnt marks where the shroud was in a fire, but the image of the man in the cloth was not on the other side of the cloth. And so when they did more studies, what they found is that the image is made up of microscopic dots. And this is one of the reasons, when they were looking, the first item that they were looking at is the question was, is this a painting?
And right. I was just going to ask you, why is it possible that this is not a painting?
Several things. If you look at a painting, the closer you go, the more detail you'll see. For example, you'll see the brush marks. You'll see maybe some of the mistakes that the artist made and so on, the closer you get. But on the shroud itself, the closer you get, the more blurred the image is until you get into a microscope. But then the fact is that you're not looking at the entire image. You're looking at just a very tiny part of it.
Right.
So the image is actually best viewed from a distance, 10 feet or more away. And that's one of the reasons why I love showing it to large crowds, because you can see the image very clearly from the back of a large room.
Elaborate more on you mentioned a moment ago that the image is actually a series of dots.
Yes, we know them as pixels because that's
right.
One of the things, you know, when you're looking at your computer monitor or your TV screen, what you're looking at is a mirage, really. You're looking at a bunch of pixels that are arrayed in such a way that it appears that there's a picture there. It's not real. It's fabricated. But the thing about the shroud itself is that the arrangement of the dots that compose the image in the shroud are closer together or basically denser where the body has come in closer contact with the cloth itself. So, for example, the darkest part of the image would be his nose. Because
that's where the pixels are clustered together more
that's
closely.
That's right. But at the same time, if you look under a microscope, those pixels are not close together in such a way that you can see any part of the image at all, which is very fascinating. So
so this is beyond they're clustered together at a density and at a size that's beyond what a human artist could paint.
That's right.
At least in the Renaissance.
Or even today. And here's another reason why. The average size of these pixels is about 10 microns. The average human hair is about 30 microns. in diameter. So in other words, if you took a piece of hair and dipped it in ink and then put a dot on the cloth.
That's still three times too big.
It's three times too big. That's right.
Wow. Wow. That's astonishing. So this is why, one reason why the image can't be reproduced.
That's right. It's, they still have not been able to determine how that image has been put onto the cloth. There are theories. But the fact is, unless you were there at the time, you would not be able to do it. There's no way to test. Well, they've been testing theories, let's put it that way, and they can come close, but they can't replicate.
We're going to do a series of episodes on scientific studies of the Shroud, talking about the photographic negative aspect of the Shroud, carbon-13 dating, all sorts of science. But so I don't want to get too bogged down in the science of it. But given, I just want to ask you, why among so many people does the idea persist that this is a painting?
Because it's an easy thing to dismiss if you say that it was made by human hands. But yet, historically, this image has been referred to as an image not made by human hands. So I find it fascinating because we can go back in history and find all the way back in the 5th century in Turkey, they referred to an image that they had in a city called Edessa, Turkey, not made by human hands. And we believe that that image was the image down the Shroud of Turin today.
Now, going back to properties of the cloth itself, we were talking earlier about the wounds and how they correspond to what we know about the crucifixion of Christ. And I tell you, this is pretty amazing. If this is not Jesus Christ in this cloth, then it belongs to some other man from the first century who was crucified, had a crown of thorns stuck on his head, was beaten up, had shoulder trauma from carrying a beam, a spear wound in the side, and fell in the streets of Jerusalem. Which is astonishingly unlikely. So just yes. Looking at the wounds, it seems like this is because the death of Jesus is so very particular. He's not just some guy that suffered a random generic crucifixion. It was a very, very unique sort of death that probably was not repeated in that specific way, at least not with this sort of specificity in that time and place. But you mentioned at the beginning of our last episode the linen cloth, the way it was woven, that this was a regal burial cloth, something that probably belonged to a rich man.
That's right.
Why is that? What's unique or what's ironic about that? How does that point to that this could have been used for Jesus Christ's burial?
Well, first of all, that was one of the first arguments against the Shroud being genuine, is that the weave was too complex to be made on a first century loom, okay, and I find that amusing because what we found is historically there's been archaeological evidence that this type of cloth was in existence. For example, there was a burial mound called the warrior mound from 4,000 years ago. And this warrior king was buried in a cloth that was 30 feet long of the same type of weave of linen as we see Jesus buried in.
So clearly the people of first century Palestine had both the skill and the technical ability to do this weave.
That's correct. What we found is at Masada, when the burial grounds there were unearthed, they found the burial site of what may have been one of the Jewish high priests. And he also had the very same cloth, the same weave, same linen as what Jesus was buried in. We also believe that Joseph of Arimathea, who was a rich man, may have also been a member of the Sanhedrin. And he had access because we believe that cloth might have only been available through the temple. At Jerusalem.
Well, so, the Gospels clearly state that the tomb was donated by Joseph of Arimathea, so what
right.
this suggests is that perhaps not only the tomb, but the burial cloth itself could have belonged to Joseph
right.
of Arimathea.
And Joseph of Arimathea was a wealthy man. He was probably, as I said, a member of the Sanhedrin. It said that he was a follower of Jesus in secret because he couldn't let it be known that he followed Jesus with his compatriots. And so what we have here, this is the enigma of the Shroud of Turin. One of the enigmas, here we have a man who died a death that was only worthy of slaves, runaway slaves, and rebels, okay? Yet this man was buried in a king's tomb, in a king's cloth or a high priest cloth. And so the idea of that this was not a commonplace thing. This is a highly unusual, to say the least. And so what we have here, and that's one of the reasons why why there is no other recording of this, because they usually don't record the crucifixions of runaway slaves and rebels that they've in areas that they've conquered. It just doesn't happen. So what we have is a puzzle here because of the type of burial that Jesus had, and the other thing about it is the complexity of the weave and the fact that this cloth was probably quite expensive, to say the least.
It's really ironic when Christ was crucified, Pilate puts up a sign that says "The King of the Jews." And the high priests and the scribes protest and say, it should say, he said, I am the King of the Jews. And Pilate says, what I have written, I have written, which it's kind of a backhanded testimony to the fact that Christ really is the King. And
yes.
And in his burial, he's wrapped in the garment that you're saying is probably reserved for the priestly class, which
That's
testifies
right.
even in his death to his priestly identity.
That's correct.
Fascinating. Now, one further question. I've heard that in the burial itself that people say that there were multiple cloths buried with the or that there was other cloths as well. Could you tell us about that?
Yes. Let's talk about and they have different names for them. One of them is the sindon. A sindon would have been the shroud itself. A sindon is known as a towel or basically, a strip of linen would be called a sindon. There's another type of cloth called a sidarium, which is a face cloth. That would be more along the lines of a handkerchief or something like that.
Which is mentioned in the Gospel of John, if I'm not mistaken.
That's right. That was rolled up and on the side in the Gospel of John. So the sidarium is what was put over the head of Jesus as he's taken down from the cross. In fact, they may have even taken a strip of cloth and tied his face, his jaw shut, as they were taking him down off the cross, and then put the sidarium over his face. Now, the reason why we say that, number one, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, but we also have the actual sidarium in a place called Oviedo, Spain, that has the same blood in the same location as what we see on the shroud, without the face and without the thorns, the crown of thorns that was on the head.
So we know of these other cloths, not so much from evidence from the shroud itself as much as other historical
evidence. And what's fascinating is that there's a big lapse in time for the Shroud of Turin. And this is one of the reasons why the scientists are so against saying that this is Jesus' burial cloth, because it first appeared in France in 1353, and that's as far as they go. But yet the sidarium actually has a record of it being taken from Jerusalem in about 630 AD, taken to Toledo, Spain, and then when the Moors conquered Spain, that same cloth was taken up into the mountains to hide it to that town called Oviedo, Spain.
Right. So once we connect the shroud with the sidarium or the image of Edessa or evidence from Constantinople, the historical pedigree goes much further back. And we're going to talk about the history of the shroud in our upcoming episodes, we're really going to dig into that. Unfortunately, that's all we have time for today. Thank you again, Tony, for another informative presentation. That is all the time we have. I'm your host, Phillip Campbell. Join us again next time for another fascinating episode of The Mystery of the Shroud. Who is the man in the cloth?